actually, you know, like
can you hear me now? Yeah? Okay, let's go. Yeah. I'll just turn it off and turn it on. Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's step back a minute. Go on, go on. What's your question? What's your question, brother?
Okay. You know, first of all, I'm feeling shy because of the camera.
No, yeah, that's okay. That's okay. We all.
Okay, so, you know, like, basically, I was standing next to you over there. And then, like, when you mentioned that, so Allah, like, is not good. So, like, what is, like, your understanding of Allah?
What is my understanding of Allah?
Yeah. Because, what? Like, you know, like, me as a Muslim. Oh, sorry. So I believe that Allah, like, it is an Arabic name for God. So it is just God, basically. You know, like, he's not, like, he doesn't have any physical form, and he's uncreated, and he's the creator, who created everything. So he doesn't have a physical form, and hence the reason, like, he has no beginning and he has no end.
But
for you, like, what is your understanding?
Okay, so from a little bit of research I've done, it doesn't take much research. You can just go anywhere. The word Allah actually derives from a pagan practice. So if you go back, when you get home, just study the Nabataeans, and you see that they were the first pagan nation that came prior to Muhammad. Okay, and they would worship Allah Matnus. They would have thousands of, when, for example, in the Quran it says that in the Kaaba there was thousands of idols which were destroyed.
Hundreds of idols.
Yes, and so. What we have is a lot of these pagan religions had this Allah as their deity, okay? Now, the word Allah, if you really look at anywhere, you can just even check it up on your phone now. Allah isn't a name. Allah is like me calling you the man. It means the God, okay? And so it's a definite article. It's not like a name, like, what's your name, sir?
Mason.
It's not me saying Mason, it's like me saying, the man's here said this, okay? So he's actually speaking in terms of his of who he is, his nature, he's the God, okay? So when we were looking at Deuteronomy 18:18, what it states clearly is that what God says to Moses is that if any man comes and prophesies or speaks in a name other than my name, then that man should be killed. So what Allah is saying is that, what God is saying in the Bible, He gives His name. He says His name is Yahweh, and we look at, you know, from the Old Testament, throughout the Old Testament, we look at how many times God visited people, and that same name came up, the name Yahweh. Okay, but yet Muhammad came as a prophet, and he came with a name other than God's name, which we get from the Torah, which Muslims believe that is from God, and so because this name. Muhammad did not use this name and say, you know, I am a prophet from Yahweh, but he simply just said, the God. Who's the God? The Buddhists have gods, or I don't know, the pagan nations have gods. So who is the God? What's his name? What's the name that he's given to his people? Muhammad gave a false name. So why would we come to the conclusion that Muhammad's a false prophet, and why Muhammad should be killed? Because he himself didn't have the name of God.
So basically, you know, like in the same words, okay, like.
Deuteronomy 18?
Yeah.
Let's read it together.
So you know, like then this verse also says that even if he, you know, like claims to preach the word in the name of the other gods, like then he should, you know, like put to death as well. But if you see it, he was never killed, was he? He just died a natural death. So
I don't understand the question, but
true,
yeah.
If this verse is true, then in that case, so Muhammad should have been put to death, but he wasn't. So, you know, so if that verse is true to its fullest, so then God would have killed him, but he didn't. And plus also, let me add another point, that one of the main founding principles of Islam is Tawheed. Tawheed is the oneness of God. So hence the reason, you know, like we believe that God is a creator and he has no physical form. Because then if he had a physical form, that means like he has a beginning. And then if he has a beginning, so then he must have an end. Hence the reason, like, we believe that he has like no beginning, no end. But it is like this paradox that...
Hey, what's up, bro? You all right? Yeah, good. Yeah.
How you been?
Yeah, I'm good, man. You good? Yeah? That's good. Go on, keep speaking. Yeah. Go on.
So it is like this paradox that, you know, like, let's say, for instance, if you have infinite number of oranges, okay, then out of those infinite number of oranges, if you remove five oranges, how many have you got left? So the answer is still infinite.
Yeah,
some
yeah.
people say that, no, it is how many is infinite minus five. But it is a paradox, because as it is, like, you already have the infinite number of oranges, so then if you do remove five out of it, so then how can you have, like, minus five?
Okay, it's infinite. Okay, let's deal with your first point. Your first point, let's read from verse 20, Deuteronomy verse 20. But the prophet who speaks a word presumptuously in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or which he speaks in the name of other gods. Okay, remember I mentioned earlier that the name or the word Allah comes from the Nabataeans, the pagan gods that came prior to Muhammad. Okay? And he speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet shall die. Now, who was doing the killing? This is the law. This is part of the...
Let me finish.
This is the law that God was given to the Israelites, okay? And what he was giving this law to Israelites, who were to, if these people broke God's law, it would be the Israelites that would kill them. So there's a law to Israelites that if false prophets come and speak in another speak about another god, or speaks presumptuously, or in other words, prophesies or something false, then you should kill him. It wasn't God that was going to kill him; he was commanding the Israelites to kill him. Muhammad comes 700 years after Jesus, thousands of years after this prophecy. He's in a completely different nation. He's not under the Israelites. He's not living in Israel. He's in Arabia, okay? And so we didn't have that law in Arabia for him to be killed, okay? But here, this scripture is attributed to the Israel at the time. But the point we're making is that if this is same Muhammad, okay, that you are saying is written in our text, what the text, it kind of is self-defeating, because what happens is that the same prophet is to be killed if he doesn't come in the name of Jesus. So if this is Muhammad, what he's essentially saying, what you're doing is you're condemning Muhammad to death, because it says that same prophet should be killed. That's the point we're making. Do you understand? And so in terms of the second point you made about God is one, what does the scripture say? Again, in Deuteronomy 6:4, it says that our Lord, the Lord God is one. This is what Christians believe. You're never going to find in the Bible where the Christians, or where, you know, Old Testament to New Testament, where anywhere in the scripture where it says God is three gods. No, we never find that. So Christians don't believe that. It's a misconception. What we do really believe is that God is one, okay, and one God in three persons. And what you have to understand, and what is interesting is this. I just want to ask you something really quickly in terms of what we're speaking about. Because when you read the Quran, it speaks about Allah refers to... okay, let me read it for you. Surah 5, ayah 116 to 117. It says, "Oh Jesus, did you say, take me and my mother as gods apart from God? It was not for me to say that to which I have... to say that to which I have no right." Okay, so...
Surah 5,
116, yeah.
Sorry. Surah 5 and... verse
116.
Okay.
So where here's Allah saying, "Oh Jesus, did you say take me and my mother as gods apart from God? It was not for me to say that to which I have no right." So what Allah is saying, Jesus, did you actually say that there's three gods? Myself, your mother, Mary, and you? You have no right. So
one second, let me just read this verse.
Yeah, go and read it. Yeah, sure.
"Oh Jesus, son of Mary, did you say to the people, take me and my mother as deities besides Allah? He will say, exalted are you. It was not for me to say that to which I have no right. If I said it, you would have known it. You know what is within myself, and I do not know what is within yourself."
Yeah. So my question on this verse...
He knows what is within myself, but I don't know, like, what is within yourself.
So my question to you is...
So he said, okay, so...
Keep reading.
So then he finishes off saying... that indeed it is you who is the knower of the unseen.
Mm.
So only God knows,
right.
You know, like, I mean, like, he's the knower of the unseen. So he has the knowledge of the hour, basically.
Okay, so this is the point I'm trying to make to you, okay? Let me just read you these two other verses just to make that point as clear as possible.
Yeah.
So Surah 5, 72, 75 also said, "God is the third of three. His mother was just a woman. They both ate food. And then here where it says in Surah 6, 101, it says, Surah 5, 17, Allah is the Messiah. We never, I'm reading the wrong one. Okay, here it is. Surah 4, 171 says, O people of the book, the Messiah, Jesus, son of Mary, was but a messenger of Allah. Do not say three gods. It is better for you to indeed, Allah is but one God. Exalted, he is above having a son. So my question to you is this. Is here it says, Jesus, Allah is asking Jesus, did you claim that you, myself, and your mother are three gods? And in the next, and in this verse I've just read you, it's saying that Christians do, or it's saying believers do not say three gods, but say only one God. Which Christians, or where in the Bible does it say there are three gods? Number one. And number two, which Christians believe that the Trinity, if you like, or is made up of Mary, Allah, and Jesus? Where did Allah get this from?
According to my understanding, the Trinity has to be like with the Holy Ghost and Jesus and God.
So why is Allah saying this?
Hang on a second.
Surah 5, 116. Okay. You've already read that. Surah 4, 171.
Okay, so hang on.
Surah 4, 171.
So this surah is 4 and 171, okay?
Yes.
All people of the scripture, do not commit excess in your religion or say about Allah except the truth. The Messiah Jesus, the son of Mary, was but a messenger of Allah and his word which he directed to Mary and the soul from him. So believe in Allah and his messengers and do not say three. Desist. It is better for you.
Right.
Indeed, Allah is but one God. Exalted is He above having a son. To Him belongs whatever is in the heavens and whatever is on the earth. And sufficient is Allah as the disposer of affairs.
So my question is to you is this, is that where is it that Christians ever in the, let's start with the Bible, because that's what Christians believe, yes? Where do Christians ever say that the Trinity or there are three gods, number one, and number two, where did they say that the three God, the Trinity is made up of Jesus, Mary, and Allah? Because this is what Allah is claiming here.
Right.
So the all-knowing Allah should know, right? They should know our belief. He should know what Christians believe, that we believe in the Trinity. So why is it that he's describing the Trinity as Mary, Jesus, and Allah? When we believe is God, Jesus, and Holy Spirit. So all knowing Allah should know. So could you explain that to me?
Okay, so, well, you know, first of all, like, let me just say that also I haven't read the whole Holy Quran. Okay, like, from start to finish. Okay. And plus, I'm not a minister of religion.
Okay. But you've read this bit. You can answer this bit, yeah?
Yes.
Yeah.
And the second thing also you have to understand is that the Holy Quran was not revealed as a whole book at once. The second thing you have to understand is that the whole chapters of the Holy Quran, because you have different chapters, like the chapter of the cow, and you have the chapter of Maryam. All these chapters were not revealed at once. The Holy Quran was revealed one verse at a time at different instances. So let's say, like, for now, if there was, you know, like, something happened, if there was a Sahaba and he asked the Holy Prophet a question, okay, so like, then a verse would be revealed from God.
Do you understand the question?
So my understanding is that possibly so if the translation is true, so at that time the Holy Prophet was dealing with the Christians who believed in those three to be gods. Hence the reason God revealed this ayah at that point in time to give an explanation to that.
Yeah. Do you understand my question?
Yes, because I understand your question.
Yeah, what is my question?
So you are saying basically that why has God mentioned those three?
Let me clear it up for you.
Yeah.
Why is God saying that Christians believe that the Trinity is made up of Allah, Mary, and Jesus? Which Christians in history ever believed that?
Yeah, so, yes. Hang on. So my response to that is that it is possible that, you know, so at that time, the Christians with whom he was are dealing with. Mm. So like they used to believe like in those three. Hence
but we don't have that. That's what I'm asking you, because we look through our history.
I don't know the history because I'm not the expert in religion.
That's fine. But you see the problem we have, because we look through history, because obviously the Torah and the Injil came prior to Muhammad. Okay? We look at what we have in the 4th century, in the 5th century, in the 6th century, and obviously Muhammad comes in the 7th century. And we have nothing of Christians believing that the Trinity is made of Mary, Allah, and Jesus. We have nothing. In addition to that,
you
can look at the context, look at what you want.
Okay.
In addition, we don't have anywhere in the Bible that says there are three gods. So why is it all-knowing Allah, all-omniscient Allah, is getting the basics wrong? He's getting the essentials, the what you call Taweed, the fundamentals. Why doesn't he not know this about, if he's meant to be revealing this Quran to all of mankind, how comes he doesn't know the basics? Even Muslims in the park understand the Trinity better than Allah.
Yeah, so again, you know, like I said, that first of all, because I don't know the history, but because you see like each word.
You see the problem though?
Yes. Now, please let me just answer. Mm. So basically, you know, so every verse that was been revealed, it has its own history behind it. That like, why was it revealed, and at what instant in time was it revealed? So to be honest, like I said, so I have no knowledge about this word. That when it was revealed, at what I mean, like what situation was the Holy Prophet was facing at that time, and hence this was revealed.
Yes.
So I would say.
Yeah. Sure.
So I would say that I can't answer that question.
That's fine. So, but you see the problem we have, because the Quran gives us a challenge. It says if you find any contradiction, because these are literally the word of Allah verbatim. It's God's word, yes? If you find any contradiction, if you find anything that's false in the Quran, then dispose of the Quran, dispose of God. Do not believe it. It's a challenge from Allah. He's saying, can you find any contradictions? Can you find any flaws? And that's what is challenging us. And here we're seeing a clear, apparent flaw that Allah didn't even know the basics of what Christians believe. And this is why Muslims walk around and they say things like, oh, you believe in three gods? We're in the Bible. They can't find it. They will say things like, oh, hold on. Well, just a minute, let me just finish here. They'll make claims like, okay, well, in our Quran, it says, you know, it speaks about Mary, you know, Allah and Jesus as the Trinity, but we've never believed that. And so what I'm saying to you is that if you're finding these clear flaws, these problems from this Quran, what you need to do is you need to go to the prior books. That's what the scripture says, right? According to the Quran, it says, if you're not sure, go to the people of the book. Yes? And they will be able to bring you affirmation and truth. And so when you go to the Gospels, you go to the Torah, what you find is you find, number one, in the Gospels, where Jesus is worshipped as God, where Jesus is, he himself, especially being God, he uses divine titles, you know, and God, you know, says he's his only begotten son. And when you look into the Torah, again, you see that God is one. Christians have never believed that God is three, or three gods, shall I say, believe that one being a three person. So what you have to now do is you have to, as a truth seeker, as someone who's honest, as someone who really genuinely wants to, you know, to make it to heaven or make it to paradise, yes? You have to go away and you have to look at these, ponder it. Because what's happened is Muslims have started going away and looking at things for themselves, and they realize this is nonsense. And they've left Islam and they've come to the truth of Jesus Christ. And that's what I would encourage you to do.
Yeah. So then, even like on the other hand as well, like there are so many Christians that who have actually left Christianity and came to the fold of Islam. So I think it is a two-way street. And plus also like there's a verse in the Bible that says that, you know, like this book was only been meant for the people of that time. But there's a verse in the Holy Quran that says that this book is for the all of mankind. So, yeah.
There you go.
Yeah. But it's like the main point that, for the main reason that I started this talk was because, you know, like you had a...
Distort me 1818.
Yeah.
Yes.
But... So yes, obviously, you know, like these verses like which you have mentioned. Mm. So like I said, that I'm not expert in religion. Mm. So I will look into it.
Yeah, okay. Which is it? Remind me, Mason. Is it Mason?
Mason.
What other?
S-U-M. S-U-M.
Mason.
Yeah, not Mason.
Mason. What's your name? Nice to meet you. Godwin. Nice to meet you. Mason, what I would appreciate you do is go away and really, you know, because listen, I was brought up in a Christian family, Christian background. And sometimes, if we be honest, we're a bit biased because we know culturally we've come up from this type of background and our environment is a particular way. So I'm assuming that you were brought up in an Islamic background. Your parents are Muslim, I'm assuming, okay? And so sometimes we have the bias, but what we have to do is we have to be honest with ourselves. And we have,
to be honest, and we have to go
back and look at things for ourselves. Because at the end of the day, when we stand before God, God's not going to say, oh, what did your parents believe? Or what did they teach, in your, what did your imam teach in the mosque? He's going to ask you, what did you research and study and know about me? How did you see, well, you know, what did I reveal to you? And if you start waffling and start, let me just finish my point. If you start saying, well, hold on, do you know what? I saw the truth, but I rejected it anyway. Then you understand that you deserve whatever judgment comes to you.
Yeah,
that's why I'd ask you to repent, sir.
But listen, you see, like you are talking about terms of all these revelations, but wouldn't you agree?
How much time we got left? Amen, go on, go on.
You know, like you're talking about all these revelations, wouldn't you agree that throughout hundreds of years, the Bible has been modified? So many verses have been added.
Can I respond to that?
Have been removed. Yeah. So many of them.
Can I respond to that?
What, so how can it be like a,
what is, be what like does the Quran say about the Bible being changed, or the Bible being corrupted, or the Bible being modified? Where does the Quran ever, where does Allah or Muhammad ever
know,
say that?
I don't know.
Exactly. Yeah. So even Allah, so what happens is that Muslims in Speaker's Corner believe that they know better than Allah. Because Allah never said the Bible's been modified. Let me just make my point. I'm asserting this because you've made a claim which Allah didn't claim. You made a claim which Muhammad didn't claim. Just a minute, brother. Yeah? So Allah has made a claim that go back to the Injil. If you're not sure, go to the people of the book. Allah has said the Torah, stand upon the Torah. And so he's saying, he's affirming these books. What you're essentially saying to me is that he's saying to you, go back to a corrupt book. Go back to a modified book. Go back to a book that, you know, has some deception in it. That's what you're saying. And what you're doing is you're basically abusing Allah. Because you're saying that, because you're saying that Allah doesn't know what he's speaking about and you know better than Allah. We'll finish up in a little, yeah, just wait there. Yeah, go on. So do you understand what I'm saying? So if Allah or Muhammad didn't say it, you should not contradict Allah or Muhammad by saying, yes, be modified. Because they told you to go to it. So Allah would not send you to...
Like it's a fact, isn't it?
But where... Yeah. Number one, where does Allah say that? Where does Muhammad say that?
Yeah, but Allah... Oh. Yes, I mean, you know... So like, he doesn't say that in the book. That, you know, like...
I'm coming to you.
I don't know, like, of any words that does say that, you know, those books have been modified.
Mm.
But also, like, you have, like... For us human beings, like, we have to understand the fact that when something which is called the Holy Book has been changed, then it is no longer the Word of God, is it?
Okay, let me respond to you, then I'm going to give this guy a chance, yeah?
Yeah.
Let me respond to you. Yeah, go on.
And plus also I'm sure that you have seen like several references to the contradictions like in the Bible as well. There are hundreds of contradictions. Starting from scientific, and so all the way to Jesus himself. Like in some words, it's like he says, like he's God, and in some words, it's like he says that I just come as a messenger of God. So,
okay, let me respond to that. So, can I respond to that? Yeah, so number one, okay, there is no, I mean, Muslims make this claim all the time. They'll say there's contradictions, but they won't be able to show us one contradiction.
There are
number
several.
Two, hold on. Yeah. Brother, let me respond, and then you can come with me. Number one. Number two, they're saying, we've got 5 minutes. Number two, they're saying that this book has been modified. So essentially what they're saying is that, or corrupted, yes? So what they're essentially saying is that God, so Allah and Muhammad are sending to a book that could possibly deceive you, okay? That could possibly take you on the wrong track. God is supposed to be all truth. That's one of his 99 names. But yet he's giving you a bit of lies and a bit of truth, and he's sending you there rather than saying, no, leave that book alone, take the last revelation of the Quran and accept it as truth. Forget about the Bible. And so what you're doing is like you're basically kind of shooting yourself in the foot, because what you're saying is that you know better than God.
No, I never said that.
But what you are saying is you're contradicting what Allah says.
No.
Because you're saying to be modified. Okay, let me just finish my point.
Yeah.
And what I would say about this is that is when you look, I mean, just away from, just in, if we just go into history a little bit, when you go into history, you look from even from the board, I'm going to give you some fragments, the Codex Sinaiticus, the Codex Alexandrinus, the Codex Vaticanus, these are all complete Bibles prior to Muhammad. We see all the manuscripts, we see the fragments, we see the archaeological digs and excavation. So we know what the Bible is. And we still have that Bible because we have the manuscripts. You can go to the British Museum and you see the Bible completed. This is prior to Muhammad. Muhammad comes 700 years later in another nation, speaking a different language. You know, he comes to the Jews and the Christians and say, I am your prophet. They reject him. Okay? Because they say, no, you're teaching something false. You come with another God, another name, that's not Yahweh. You come with another teaching, and they reject him. That's why, he ends up murdering many innocent Jews at the Bani Karaizi tribe. But anyway, the point I'm making is this, is that rather than go with the historical books, you're going with your own kind of, because the Bible contradicts what the Quran says, it's what we call the Islamic dilemma. If the Bible is true, then Muhammad's a false prophet. If the Bible is false, then Muhammad's a false prophet. It's called the Islamic dilemma. Because if the Bible is true, it speaks about God in three persons, it speaks about Jesus being God, it speaks about all of these things. If the Bible is false, okay, then why did Allah tell you to go to the Bible, go to the Torah, go to the Injil? So you have a dilemma. What I say is, we have to round off now.
Yeah.
What I say to you is, like I said, leave this contradiction, come to Jesus.
Revealed at a different time.
The true Torah, but not the ones who are being manipulated. Yeah,
exactly. Right. But every word.
Okay. We've heard what you had to say, and so this is round up. Say your last thing, yeah.
Every word was revealed come at a different time, like I said from before. So it is possible that at that time, that the Muslims were facing something. Like, for example, when the Muslims who were being exiled and they went to Ethiopia, who was the king that saved them? Oh, he was a Christian.
Two minutes, finish up.
But the Muslims were being attacked and like they, you know, like left their place and they went, to Abyssinia.
Yeah, you have to quick, make your point quickly.
He was a Christian king
who
saved them. So it's possible that when this verse was revealed, they were facing a situation, and hence the reason like this was revealed. But like I said, so I don't have the full knowledge.
Yes.
So
come back again. Go research. Go study.
Ambiguous. Yeah.
Take care, Minister.
Nice
yeah.
To
nice to meet you.
Bless.
Yeah. God bless you. Yeah.
Take
All right.
Care.
Okay. So as again, you know, speak to our Muslim friends. We just want them to look at the facts. Don't take our word for it. Look at what manuscripts we have, what evidence we have to show that we had the Bible prior to Muhammad. Muhammad comes and contradicts the Bible. Allah says, go to the Injil, go to the Torah. This is where his word is. Muhammad never ever throws the Torah or the Injil under the bus. He says, this is the word that I've revealed. But yet Muslims will come and say, well, it's been corrupted. The word Allah told us to go to has been corrupted. And I'll say, stay away from the lies and deceptions of the Quran, Islam and Muhammad. Come to the truth of Jesus Christ. Jesus loves you.
There's no lies. Nothing, no lies.